Good morning, folks. The Atheist Community of Austin is a proud sponsor of Austin's only live atheist talk show, with today's featured guest coming fresh from his battles with the trials and tribulations of being a cyber atheist, Denis Loubet. And back to Vic Farrow.
I'm here.
Back out from his vacation. Welcome back, Vic.
Hey.
And today's host, as always, is the genius behind that newest board game to hit the nation, War Chest, Jeff Dee. Take it away, Jeff.
Thanks, Ray. Hi, folks. Welcome to the Atheist Experience.
Trying to do better with that.
This show is brought to you by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. We are live February 20, 2000 CE. We have weekly meetings Sunday mornings at the Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop, 307 West 5th Street at 10:30 a.m. right after the show, except for the first Sunday of each month when we have our lecture series at 11 a.m. at Furs Cafeteria instead. Our next lecture will be taking place on Sunday, March 5th. ACA board meetings take place at noon right after our regular meeting on the second Sunday of every month. These meetings are open to all ACA members, but you can only vote if you're on the board of directors. The last board meeting was supposed to take place last week, but has been postponed until today. So this will be a board meeting day.
Which is a good thing, since I wasn't here last week.
That's right. Well, we got other board members that aren't here this week, so we take what we can get. For more information, you can call our voicemail at 371-2911 or visit our website at www.atheist-community.org. This show can also be seen on the internet. Tune your browser to spring.net, and there's a real video, streaming video version of the show going there. Of course, if you're watching us now, you don't need that, but if you have friends out of state anywhere around the planet, they can get on the internet and watch our show. We're really excited about that. Okay. Today's guest is my longtime friend, Denis Loubet, fellow artist.
Hello.
We've worked together at a couple of different companies. And Denis, you spend a lot of time arguing with theists on the internet, don't you?
More than I should, yeah. I have work to do, but I spend a lot of time arguing with theists on the internet. I go to the news group Alt Atheism. There are various news groups on the net. Alt Atheism is one of them. News groups are basically big bulletin boards. People put posts on the news group, and everybody else in the world can read those posts. The news groups conveniently organize them into threads of conversation. So
when you
people
respond,
basically can have a question-answer kind of discussion going on. The advantage of this is it allows you to really think out your reply and then type it in. So
right.
You're not firing answers off the cuff.
I've spent a lot of time on news groups too, but not as much as you.
Well,
before we get into some of your interesting experiences in news groups, talking to the theists and so on.
As interesting as you can get typing on a keyboard.
let's go to Vic with the morning's news.
Okay.
And I have a couple other things here if you want to do those after.
Someday.
Oh, yes.
Right, there's the camera. Moving over here.
There we go.
I have to talk to this camera today. All right. Just two of them today. The scientists who are trying to understand the origins of the universe have moved a step closer, creating a primordial soup of subatomic particles that they believe resemble the universe during the earliest moments of creation. The discovery is a breakthrough in the attempt to study the exact moment of the Big Bang. The experiment scientists at CERN, the European Laboratory for Particle Physics, we're able to recreate a state of matter that hasn't existed since the first few microseconds after the explosion. Scientists have long believed that in the moments after the explosion, quarks and gluons, the smallest known particles, floated freely in space. Afterwards, they joined to form larger particles that went on to make up all the matter in the universe. But until now, the scientists have never had compelling evidence that free-floating quarks and gluons ever existed. They've seen particles in their trapped state as part of the larger matter. In the CERN experiments, 350 scientists from the United States, Europe, Japan, and India were able to generate heat 100,000 times greater than the center of the sun. The resulting plasma, or soup, fleetingly contained thousands of freely floating quarks.
Huh.
Interesting stuff, huh?
So matter can exist in the state that they thought it did in the first few seconds of the
right. Well,
first few microseconds.
Now,
this
is really early on. The better results will be possible after work shifts next year to a new relativistic heavy ion collector at Brookhaven National Laboratory on New York's Long Island.
This is another example of predictions of science panning out.
Right. Yeah, they,
all right.
This stuff's supposed to be there. And if this is accurate, if the tests at CERN are correct, the new collider in New York will verify it.
All right.
And so that's one story. Now's the good story. I don't think you're going to be able to get a good shot of this, but you could try. Trying, attempting.
Yeah, don't move it around.
It's certainly colorful.
Well, I didn't know what camera he was on. All right. This is a rock. It's a very large rock floating out in space. This is 433 Eros, an asteroid orbiting our sun, but it also crosses the Earth orbit. They just sent a satellite up to meet with this. That's my next story.
And it's orbiting it, right?
And it is currently in orbit with Eros. On February the 14th, Valentine's Day, the NEAR, or Near-Earth Asteroid Rendezvous spacecraft, began its year-long study of the Near-Earth asteroid named after the Greek god of love. The timing was mostly for technical reasons. The asteroid's trajectory and orbital parameters set a window for NEAR to meet up with Eros, but there was just enough flexibility in this calculation to set up a Valentine's Day date. The spacecraft even sent back pictures of a crater shadow that looked like a heart. Asteroid 433 Eros, the 433rd asteroid to have its orbit calculated, will be studied with a variety of instruments, including a magnetometer, an X-ray gamma-ray spectrometer, the near-infrared spectrometer, the multispectral imager, and a laser rangefinder. Also, a radio experiment will determine the asteroid's mass by tracking tiny changes in NEAR's radio frequency. Constructed at the Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Laboratory and launched February 17, 1996, the two Delta II rockets used to launch NEAR from Cape Canaveral's air station was the smallest rockets ever used for a planetary mission. Made of 18 square foot aluminum panels, NEAR is 9 foot 2 inches long, including its main antenna. NEAR's four solar panels, each 6 feet long and 4 feet wide, surround the diameter high-gain antenna atop the spacecraft. Including the propellants and the instruments, NEAR weighed 1,775 pounds at launch. The NEAR mission aims to answer fundamental questions about the nature and origin of many asteroids and comets close to Earth's orbit. These near-Earth objects may contain clues about the formation of the Earth, other planets, even the whole universe. Eros' pristine surface and lack of significant gravity offer a look at the conditions in space when Earth was formed more than 4.5 billion years ago. Asteroids that come within 121 miles of the Sun are known as near-Earth asteroids. Eros is one of the largest near-Earth asteroids, with a mass thousands of times greater than similar asteroids. Potato-shaped Eros is about 21 miles long, 8 miles wide, and 8 miles thick. Most of the near-Earth asteroids we know about are little more than half a mile across. Theory holds that most of these NEAs, or near-Earth asteroids, broke away from the main asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. And aside from the Moon, they're our closest neighbors in the solar system. Their orbits come close enough that one could eventually hit Earth, but scientists who track the near-Earth asteroids say that a collision won't likely occur within the next several thousand years. NEAR was supposed to reach Eros 2 years, 327 days after launch, but the failed orbit insertion attempt on December the 20th of 1998 forced the mission designers to add another year and 23 days to the trip. All told, NEAR's journey to Eros will end 5 days short of 4 years. NEAR's flyby of Eros on December 23rd of 1998 showed the asteroid to have at least two medium-sized craters, a 12-mile surface ridge, a density comparable to Earth's crust, and a diverse surface makeup. When NEAR reached Eros on February the 14th, it had traveled 1,875 billion miles, and it still has another 419 million miles to go during its year-long orbit. Eros was about 160 million miles from Earth. This comes out to 1.7 astronomical units. One astronomical unit, about 93 million miles, is the average distance between Earth and the Sun. So it's out there, it's floating around for another year, and it's gonna be constantly sending back some just fabulous pictures. This, my printer doesn't make really good pictures, but...
And that's a stereoscopic image.
It's a stereoscopic image.
It's not really pink and blue, folks.
Yeah, this is taken from a different kind of imaging product.
And I've heard all kinds of interesting tidbits of information about that asteroid. One is they think they've detected geological strata in it, leading to the suspicion that it may be a piece of a roughly moon-sized planet that broke up.
Yeah, it could either be a moon-sized or a planetary size, something that was either impacted or broke up somehow, and it's a piece of it going away.
It's got a mysterious white spot on it.
The mysterious white spot is...
But they know what that is now?
They don't know what that is just yet. They got a year to study all this stuff.
And the two ends of it, according to an infrared image, are warmer than the middle.
I didn't read that part.
Which is weird.
Oh,
they're going to figure all that out.
I was at the website getting all this information.
Are they going to brush the asteroid with one of the
I had read
arrays?
A story that they're thinking of towards the end of the mission when they've collected all the data they want. Is to go by with one of the solar panels and just scratch the surface and then take a picture of that scratch to see what kind of damage it'll do. But that's going to be left up to the mission control people to decide towards the end of the mission.
And that's assuming they even still have a spacecraft after scraping it along the asteroid.
Well, the solar panel would probably break up, but if they time it just right, you should be able to go by and just bump it.
That's graffiti. That rocks, man.
It's going to orbit 125 days at 31 miles, and at other times they extend the orbit to 300 miles. And in December of 2000, it will descend to 22 miles and operate from that distance or closer for the rest of the mission. And after that, that's when they may go down. And
man, I wonder what its orbital speed is. It's got to be like,
faster than that. That's what they're going to calculate is some of the orbital speed and trajectory more accurately of Eros as it goes around the sun. But to give you an idea of how big this rock really is, if you set it on top of Manhattan Island, there would be no Manhattan Island. It would just
be one big rock. Wow.
But I was reading an article where they were saying putting the satellite into orbit around the asteroid was difficult because of the extremely low gravity.
Right. It has a 1/1000th, I think, of the gravity. If you weigh 200 pounds on Earth, you weigh like 2 ounces on Eros. You could jump out of a 12-mile crater.
Right. You could hit escape velocity by jumping, I'm sure.
You could easily just twitch and be off the rock in no time.
Yep. Well, I got a couple of neat news items, too. Some of these were forwarded to me by Denis here.
Oh, good.
Justice Department won't investigate group. Washington, the Justice Department has turned down a request by Republican senators to investigate the activities of a group that promotes the separation of church and state. Deputy Assistant Attorney General John Keeney said in a letter that the department found no voter intimidation involved in efforts by the Americans United for Separation of Church and State to warn churches that they were jeopardizing their tax status by participating in Christian Coalition voter registration drives. Quote, "For that reason, we declined to initiate a criminal investigation, Keeney wrote to Americans United Executive Director Barry Lynn last week. If the Christian Coalition and its political cronies thought they could harass and bully Americans United into dropping its effort to educate churches about the perils of partisan political activity, they were wrong," Lynn said in a statement on Friday. Last July, 6 Senate Republicans, including Senator Jesse Helms of California, Jeff Sessions of Alabama, and Paul Coverdale of Georgia, asked Attorney General Janet Reno to launch a criminal investigation into whether Americans United had violated citizens' right to vote by, quote, "intimidating people of faith into not participating in the political process," unquote. Sessions had no immediate comment on the Justice Department decision, but thinks Americans United is one of the most aggressively left-wing organizations in America, his spokesman John Cox said. Sessions is offended by their suggestion that churches may lose their tax-exempt status by allowing the Christian Coalition to conduct voter registration drives, Cox added. then he's offended by the Constitution of the United States, apparently. The request to Reno was linked to Americans United's advice to churches that they could lose their tax-exempt status if they distributed biased voter guides to their congregations. The group in particular warned of voter guides prepared by the Christian Coalition, which had lost its request for tax-exempt status after the Internal Revenue Service concluded that some of its activities were too partisan. So that's good news. Once again, the forces of theism trying to harass... In fact, Americans United for Separation of Church and State is a very theistic organization. That is not an atheist group. They're not humanists. They're not materialists. They don't identify themselves as free thinkers or anything like that. They are people who think that the separation of church and state is a pretty good idea, even from the point of view of churches, and they just try to hold that line.
Well, maybe we should explain about tax statuses from some of these groups to someone who doesn't understand or know.
Okay.
Like ours is a 501c3 educational status, and I don't think we're allowed either to get involved in like party politics or
we're not.
Or stuff like that.
We
if
have,
you do, been, you get in trouble and you lose your status.
There have been some discussions of political activism in our organization, but they are always nonpartisan. It's
right.
Simply encouraging people to get out and register to vote and vote
right.
for whoever they think is the right person to vote for. Here's a new thing. I'm just going to paraphrase this story, but apparently they have genetically engineered a derivative of the Streptococcus mutans bacteria, which is well known to be the chief cause of tooth decay. This new variant doesn't make the lactic acid, which causes tooth decay. It makes some other stuff that is relatively harmless, and it has the ability to kill off the version of that bacteria that does cause tooth decay. And they're saying that this could lead to a treatment within a year and a half, according to this article, where you would go to your dentist, swish around a mouthful of this stuff with the new bacteria in it, and then be advised by your dentist to go out and eat a bunch of sugar. Because the sugar will feed the new bacteria, which will then start competing with the old bacteria, and since
That's
they
right.
can kill the old bacteria, it'll wipe them out, and your mouth will be inhabited by some crunching noises. And your mouth will be taken over by these things that will actually protect you from tooth decay when you eat sugar.
That would be a good thing.
Awesome.
Now, there's an interesting question I thought of when I read that, going, could this be spread through a kiss?
Well, I would think so. I would think it could.
Could it be spreading?
Interesting. A beneficial...
sexually
a beneficial transmitted. Okay.
Of course, you know it's only a matter of time before the forces in our society that try to elevate evolution to the level of, you know, godlike authority over our lives are going to start screaming and yelling that, oh, we mustn't be genetically engineering things because all kinds of horrible things can happen. They are right that bad things can happen when we tinker with stuff, but they are wrong that means it is reasonable to completely refrain.
Right.
I mean, care needs to be taken,
right.
but it would be foolish of us not to apply the knowledge we have painstakingly extracted from the universe about how it works.
Some of the concerns I would have about genetic engineering testing is that now if you get genetically tested and you found to be predisposed to a certain illness, you may lose your insurance. And how do you keep that, you know, private information private? That's a legitimate concern.
That's a legitimate concern, but some answer will be found. If
yeah,
we turn into a society where we just happen to know that stuff,
right.
some solution will be found to that problem, right?
Right. There was a story on
hopefully involving getting rid of insurance companies in the
yeah, place, right.
Well, there's also the sheer practical reason that Yeah, we can say we'll stamp out genetic engineering in our country, but what about the rest of the world? Right, we can't stamp it out there. We'll just be behind.
Right. Yeah. Which, you know, a lot of people would like to see us behind technologically, apparently. Senator's remark over religion sparks critical backlash. This has been all over the news. One senator's argument that non-Christian religions should be excluded from history lessons about colonial America has sparked outcry among fellow lawmakers. When the boat came to these great shores, it did not have an atheist, a Buddhist, a Hindu, a Muslim, a Christian, and a Jew, Republican Senator Albert Robertson told his colleagues this week. 98%+ of these people were Christians.
Who were the other 2%?
The other 2%, apparently, he thinks, shouldn't even be mentioned.
Right.
The Republican senator pushed a resolution Tuesday to have the Kentucky Board of Education stop suppression and censorship of American history as it relates to Christian influence. What an amazing way to phrase that.
If you listen to some atheistic, anti-Christ spirit on television...
And this goes back to this fundamentalist idea that they're trying to redefine American history to say that it was a Christian nation, and it never was. And it's plain if you get into it that it was never intended to be a Christian nation. And but that's not what they're telling people.
It wasn't the United States yet when the Pilgrims.
Right. Yeah.
It wasn't the United States until we had like this war with England and said we were going to be separate, right? And by then, there were lots and lots and lots of people, not just one boatload, that didn't happen to have any atheists on it.
Yeah.
The Senate changed the resolution to say Judeo-Christianity. Now check this out, right? the opponents of his thing turn around and say, "Well, we just don't. We want you to go ahead and be able to mention, like, all versions of Christianity and Judaism."
Right, but that was...
But not Muslims, and not atheists, and not Buddhists, and not Hindus, and not Wiccans.
That was to satisfy a fellow senator who is Jewish.
We know they had Wiccans because they were, like, burning them at the stake in Salem. We know there were Wiccans. Robinson objected to changing it even to Judeo-Christianity. The General Assembly's only Jewish legislator, Representative Kathy Stein, said Wednesday she is getting tired of thinly disguised attempts among her colleagues to impose a majority faith. In addition to Robinson's legislation, she singled out a proposed resolution urging schools to prohibit extracurricular activities on Sunday because of students' religious obligations, among other things. Noting that her Sabbath is from sundown Friday to sundown Saturday, Stein said, "I am beginning to get, as a mother of three children, pretty much fed up with this thing." Even some within Robinson's own party have been critical. "I can't believe we're arguing this," Senate President David Williams, a Republican, said during the debate. "We're trying to exclude people of faith, people of a common ancestry." Of course, the people of the common ancestry I think he's talking about would be the Jewish people.
Yeah.
So that's an argument in favor of adding Jews to the religions that you can mention in history.
Interesting point. If he wants to stamp out mention of all the other religions, then what you're left with is, at Salem, they must have burned good Christians at the stake and wiped out all the Native American Christians in the country.
We didn't have any Indians here.
That's cool. No, they were all good Christians.
Until these red-skinned people started miraculously appearing at the moment that they were baptized.
I guess. I don't know.
Robinson added that he never intended to be inclusive. Well, duh. By adding a reference to Judaism, he said, "We've done Christians and the Christian history of this nation a terrible injustice," he said.
Okay.
Yeah. Wow. So when are you going to start rounding people up and putting them in ovens, Mr. Robinson?
Yeah.
Some newspapers' editorial pages weighed in on the issue Thursday. "We're not sure which boat Senator Robinson had in mind," the Courier Journal of Louisville said. "Did he include the boats filled with Africans stolen from their homeland faith and brought here on slave ships?" The Kentucky Post noted that a large number of boats have come to these shores over the years. Not all of the immigrants have been Christian. Well, yeah.
You mentioned burning. That just last week on the 17th was Thursday. was the anniversary of Giordano Bruno's burning.
Giordano Bruno, a philosopher, former theologian who left the Catholic Church. This was...
And he was burned for teaching Copernicus.
Was this in the...
Whose birthday was...
1500s? 1500s, I think.
Yeah, 1500s. He was burned in... He was burned in 16... Da, 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 da.
He ran around... He left the church, ran around Europe for a few years writing books.
Right.
Finally came back to Italy where a friend that he thought he could trust turned him into the church. They kept him in prison for 8 years and then burned him alive.
Right. Also, I think it was Saturday was Copernicus's birthday.
Was it?
Yeah, I think it was Saturday or it might have been Friday. It was one of the two.
Astronomy calendar. I didn't notice that, but I'll have to keep my eyes open more carefully. We have a caller on the line. Let's take this call and then go to Dennis's stuff. Hello, George.
Good morning.
Hi, George.
Hello. Yeah.
How dare you say this is not a Christian nation?
Okay.
Thanks, Ray. Okay. Dennis.
Yes. I don't know if I can work up a belch like that, but I'll try.
So, tell us about what goes on in their news groups on the internet.
Well, there's horrible discussions of logic and reason. Basically, you know, how terrible. It was that I thought that philosophy, you know, years ago, I thought philosophy was a bunch of guys talking about a bunch of nonsense that didn't make any difference. And I was cruising the news groups and saw Alt Atheism and went, okay, I'll check that out. I looked at that, and that news group was getting about close to 1,000 new messages every day. And that's a high traffic news group. And it's ostensibly the FAQ for Alt Atheism.
The FAQ is
Frequently Asked Questions.
Document. That's a document people write up to answer questions that people might have about various things, and they put that on the web so you can find that and find out the answers to your questions before you come wandering in with, you know...
with the same question again on the newsgroup.
Never works.
And it's for atheists to discuss atheist matters, like, you know, how do you raise children in a theistic society, how do you get married, things like that. But actually, alt atheism should be called alt convert the atheists, because what happens in alt atheism is you get all the theists coming in to try to convert the atheists. And this results, understandably, in a certain amount of friction. This friction is called flames. And
Flames are
insulting messages
right.
on the newsgroups in response to insulting messages posted on the newsgroup. So it's sort of a nice little feedback loop. But the good thing about alt atheism is that, man, it really, reading it, I realized, no, this philosophy stuff actually makes sense. It's how you can actually come to conclusions by using sheer logic and reason from premises. And actually, I got sucked up into that. That was really cool. So I'm reading this, and when you first get on a news group, it's usually a good idea to do what they call lurk. That is, you sit there and read posts, see what's going on in the news group, get an idea for what people are discussing before you barge in and start spouting your own 2 cents worth.
Get whipped soundly.
Yeah. And I discovered that the theists only had, a few arguments that you could, you know, list on maybe 2 hands. And the atheists had stock answers that they would then, do variations on. But some of the theist posters were just nuts. they'll say things that are unbelievable. They're completely absurd. some things you see on alt atheism. Newsgroups often have their own communities. Longtime posters on the newsgroups sort of take the newsgroup as their own sort of turf. And there was one atheist on the group by the name of Styx, who was an expert at the art of insult. The beauty of his posts was that while he was viciously insulting his opponents, his points were also so logically solid and crystal clear that you couldn't help but agree with everything he said. And he created his own little imaginary organization called the Bawa Knights, B-A-A-W-A, standing for Badass Atheists with Attitude. And when a atheist on the on alt atheism would post a message that was appropriately insulting while also being incisively true, he would grant them Bawa Knight status, and they could include that in their SIG file, their signature file, at the end of their messages. It's basically your name and stuff, but they'll also have Bawa Knight. Precisely.
Now, I won one of those knight reds,
right,
a few months back, of which I am intensely proud.
Well, I'm not good enough as insulting, so I don't have one.
I just got a computer the first of the year, so I just found Atheism. You know, I'm lurking. I'm in the lurking
all
state.
Right.
You're lurking
on Atheism.
So,
all right.
I'll lurk for a while, then I'll go after my knighthood.
There's also a lot of the atheists on alt atheism have what they call atheist numbers. Well, that was in response to a message a long time ago asking some theist posting that he thought there were only one or two atheists on alt atheism posing as about 100. And so this one atheist started giving out numbers to all the atheists. And what are the numbers up to now? Is it in the thousands?
It is yet? In the thousands.
Yes, it is in
oh,
the thousands.
My.
There's lots of atheists on atheist news groups. So, yes, alt atheism has its heroes. It also has its villains. There was one poster several years ago. I don't think I was on the news group when he was posting. When I got to alt atheism, there was one character that people referred to time and again called Nameless. That's not what he called himself. That's what they called him. They used to say, "We will never mention his name again." So he's always called Nameless.
Well, he's been banned.
And frankly, I'm not even sure what his real name
is.
Well,
you can't kick people off news groups.
No, right.
Well, there are moderated news groups that has somebody who has the authority to delete people from the group. But
right.
Alt atheism is not a moderated news group. Anybody can come in there, but there are ground rules.
Right.
You know, and then it's a question of peer pressure. You know, but when you violate the ground rules, they try to drive you off.
They try to drive you off, but there's nothing official they can do unless you're spamming. Then they can talk to your ISP and say, "Hey, kick this guy off."
Spamming is.
I don't know. You're better. What spamming is posting, like if a theist came in and started preaching, the same as
flagrantly posting a bunch of messages in violation of the ground rules.
Yeah. That's enough to get a message to your ISP to get you removed from the internet.
For those of you who might be out there watching our show over the net, in case you can't read the text at the bottom of the screen, that is our live call-in number. You can call us from anywhere in the world. And just mention to our call screener that you are calling long distance, and we'll get you on right away. As a matter of the number is 512-472-2255. And we have a long-distance call on right now, but...
go for it.
It's Joe Zamecki, who used to be on this show himself. Hi, Joe.
Good morning.
What's up, man?
Hey, how you doing? I'm having trouble seeing y'all on spring.net.
Really?
Go back to Lindrum. Yeah.
Typical.
I'm logged in.
Yeah, what's it doing?
Well, it's just showing one screen, a previous shot, I guess one frame. It's frozen.
Oh, yeah.
And it doesn't do any sound.
No,
and
sound?
It doesn't do any sound.
Yeah, it must be a lot of traffic or something.
Hmm.
It could be. Anyway.
Maybe they think we're a webcam.
Right.
Well, it used to be. Now, you're using real video?
What's that?
Are you using real video?
No. Yeah, real player.
Real player, yeah.
Yeah, that should do.
And I clicked on sound only. Go ahead and find that story.
Hmm.
Look at that.
Hmm.
Anyway.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we'll talk to Spring.net about that.
Right. Gosh, I just got kicked offline, too, so I'm fumbling
here.
Hey,
you're having so many technical problems. I think the devil's trying to come against your program.
Oh, I love that. It's a classic. I just had one little article I wanted to read from the Landover Baptist Church website.
Okay.
Oh, no.
Landover Baptist is a fictitious, tongue-in-cheek Christian website.
Right, exactly.
Right.
Yes, and they put up little stories that are not true, but they sound very much similar to some that are.
Yeah.
For a small donation of $5,000 per couple, you are welcome aboard this year's complimentary free cruise for new Christians. We expect over 2,500 of our new converts, babes in Christ, to join us aboard the Landover Baptist Royal Diadem for a Mediterranean tour of the Holy Land this summer. Young believers aged 64 to 92 are in for the time of their new life in Christ. Praise the Lord and pass the suntan lotion. Denying yourself and sacrificing everything you have for Jesus has never been more delightful. Get ready to have fun. Captain Jesus and our qualified saved crew will introduce you to your new religion, and you won't ever want to stop it. Praise God. Imagine drinking in the exotic sights and sounds of Jesus' old stomping grounds, indulging in world-class shopping at every port. You will discover a treasure trove, a bounty of the world's most desirable merchandise. Tickle your Baptist taste buds with some of the Holy Land's secret mouth-watering recipes. Best of all, it's 100% free. Your $5,000 donation doesn't have a thing to do with the cruise. And they show a picture of a lovely Christian cruise boat, and I guess that's good enough. Landoverbaptist.org. It's a real funny, although not true, site.
That's a real
cool.
Fun site.
Anyway, I guess I'm going to keep at it with the Spring.net and see if
okay.
I can catch on live then.
It sounds like you may have just had a bad connection.
Possibly.
The problem could have been at urine.
AOL, maybe.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Mm.
Yeah. So, hey, and also, could you put me on hold for a couple minutes? I want to hear on the phone first.
Sure, absolutely.
Thanks, and y'all have a great day.
You too.
You too.
All right.
See you.
Joe was the co-host at one time, and he's went on to New Jersey because he works for American Atheists.
That's right. And doing excellent work out
yes.
there.
Yeah. And his email address, I can never get anything through. It always gets kicked back.
Oh, we should have. We can take him off hold and ask him.
No, it says something about attachments.
Hey, Joe?
Yeah.
And Vic here is having trouble sending you email.
Oh,
you know
okay.
Anything about that?
I responded to a couple of emails you sent before, and they always get sent back. I think you have something that prevents an attachment from coming through.
Okay. My email address is aajoeyjr@aol.com.
Right, and that's the one. It's the one I
yeah,
said it to.
It's bouncing his messages back to him.
But every time, it's always something that's response to something that came off the atheist list.
Yeah.
And it comes back with a message that says you won't accept it because it has an attachment.
Oh, I'm sorry. My attachment box is closed too.
Okay.
I'm sorry. I get so many of those things. I just had to close them.
Yeah.
But, I could see. Yeah.
Well, you okay. The solution to that might be making sure there's no attachments to his emails when he sends them.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, let's
we'll put you back on hold.
Okay, thanks.
All right, bye. Never done that before.
Yeah, all right. Tech support.
Atheist tech support.
You call in with your computer problems.
Don't say that. They'll start calling with computer problems.
So yeah, there were. I noticed myself there were a lot of like fake organizations.
Yes,
on...
there's the Evil Atheist Conspiracy, the EAC. whenever they want to poke fun at theist fears of atheists, they'll whip out the old Evil Atheist Conspiracy, talking about the tinfoil anti-rapture helmets, the. EAC irony o-meter, which we use to protect ourselves from ironic theist posts, like if they say we have
atheists have no reason to believe what they believe will say, "Whoa, my irony meter just exploded." You know, it's amazing. We also have alt atheism has also in several invented alternatives to God to use as comparisons to God. There's the invisible purple unicorn, which
I thought it was a pink unicorn.
Purple? It is a pink unicorn.
Okay. Invisible pink unicorn?
Yeah. Well, that's it.
Well,
I'll
be going to the invisible purple, invisible pink unicorn hell then for saying purple.
Right. Committed a blasphemy.
There are those who believe that the invisible unicorn.
Thank you for coming.
They'll simply take the theist's argument and replace all references to God with invisible pink unicorn.
Right.
And say, now, doesn't that sound sensible?
So something like, for example, give us an example of the kind of thing that they would say where they would substitute, like, you know, God loves you.
Right.
So you should believe in him,
yes.
Right?
And the invisible purple unicorn. You can't disprove the invisible purple unicorn. Therefore, she exists.
Right.
And it's a she.
Right. And somebody else whips out Last Thursdayism, which is the theory, equally undisprovable, that my cat invented the universe last Thursday. All your thoughts and memories of events previous to that were placed in your brain by my cat, who invented the universe last Thursday.
A miracle! It's the happiest day of my life!
except my cat doesn't sound like that.
Well, it's speaking in cat tongues. You can't understand it.
Well.
Now, alt atheism is a great place to hone your arguments. If you're interested in arguing with theists in an environment where you can take your time, think out your response, and post it to where everybody can read it, that's a great place to go, because you'll have an amazing assortment of arguments to choose from.
It's what you were, there was a great phrase that you used once that I have adopted myself. It is a target-rich environment.
It is a target-rich environment. Precisely. One of the biggest targets is Pascal's wager, oddly enough.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. There.
For those of you at home who don't know what Pascal's wager is, the old saw about how you ought to believe in God anyway, because if you do and he doesn't exist, then you've lost nothing. But if you believe in him and he does exist, then you get to go to heaven forever.
And if you don't believe in him
you find it's your eternal hellfire. Right. Pascal was a guy who came up with that. And while he was a brilliant mathematician in many ways, that's just a crock. It doesn't work. Dennis, would you care to expound
why?
A little bit on the flaws with Pascal's wager?
The problem is they're only considering one possible God, when in fact, if you choose the Christian God and believe in him to avoid this hell that you go to, well, guess what? You could be wrong, and it's Zeus that sends you to, Hades. Yes, yeah. I should know that. Or Odin that sends you to
hell. They had hell with
they
one
had hell. Okay, fine.
Hell with one hell in Norse.
Or it could be Crom to send
so
you to Valhalla.
Any number of gods imagined or not yet imagined that could actually be in existence,
and you'd
still be wrong.
And Pascal's wagers is one of the things where you could substitute, you know, the invisible, I'm going to say pink.
Invisible pink unicorn, sure.
If you take Pascal's wager and you take out the word God and you put in the phrase invisible pink unicorn, if Pascal's wager makes sense, it makes sense no matter what God you plug in. Therefore, it doesn't make sense because it's, you
they
know,
can't all be right.
They can't all be right.
Right.
Yeah. We got another caller. Let's take it. Are you sure he's on line one?
That's what they told me.
Okay. Hello, John?
Yeah.
Hi, what can we do for you?
Well, you know, you're talking about all the religious freaks.
And I want to. I seen Benny the other day on TV.
Benny Hinn?
Yeah.
Good boy.
With his phony hair.
That's a, if you really want a good laugh, this is someone to watch.
And he said there was a baby born that only had two valves in his heart. Mother and dad went out and prayed with the preacher, and the next day they took an X-ray of the heart, and he had another valve in it.
Poof!
And he said, what a miracle.
Yes.
Again,
what a lie.
Again, if Benny Hinn wants to prove that miraculous healing takes place, he can take Alexander Holyfield, the boxer, whose mm-hmm. heart condition he claims to have fixed once by faith healing.
Yeah.
He can take him, and he can make Holyfield grow a new ear after Tyson bit off the last one. Until he can do that, there's no reason for anybody to believe in him.
Well, we can grow the ear on a rat and put it on.
We there can grow go. It on a rat. Benny right. Hill cannot blow it onto his head on stage. he cannot do. The guy cannot do anything obvious. He can. What was that sound? He gets all his mileage out of stuff where clearly what is going on is an initial misdiagnosis.
I agree with you. I you know, it was so funny when he said he only had two valves and needed another, and they prayed, and that valve appeared, and the doctors just couldn't figure it out. So I tried to call him and find out who this doctor was
and who
the X-ray technician was, or the MRI, just couldn't get through to them, you know? They just
of course
talk
not.
To you.
Amazing.
You can't answer those questions.
I'm 70-some years old, and I'm completely amazed at these people.
Yeah.
And people keep giving them money and money and money.
That's the sad part.
Yeah, and
they do it for that very reason. The reason they're out there is to make money.
Yeah, and you never see one of these guys with his ass hanging out of his jeans. You know?
No.
No.
Just to a T.
Yeah.
Got a manicure, pedicure, whole nine yards.
Oh, yeah.
You need to make a vow of faith of $1,000. Oh, Bob, couldn't you say 25? No!
Well, how about old Oral Roberts?
Oh,
he
boy.
He was in town, and the last thing was in the newspaper. He said that money seeds the faith, so send money. Did you read
We got people on welfare that's got enough faith to make a $1,000 vow and paying it.
But anyway, I just wanted to make a little comment about them.
That's one of the things I have against televangelists the most, is they really...
Oh, we lost them. Bye, Don.
Like, oh, sorry, Don. Bye. They're predators. They're working on people who are not clearly thinking about this stuff, or they have these misguided beliefs or whatever, and they sucker them into sending their money, hoping for some miracle of some kind. It's never going to show up.
And our society puts up with this.
Yes.
I mean, it's one thing to be religiously tolerant, right? To allow any religion to exist pretty much, you know, pretty much any religion to exist if people want to have that religion. It is quite another thing to look the other way while scoundrels and con artists are sucking the poor and uneducated people of our country dry by lying to them with these religious claims.
And if I got on the
quite another thing.
If I got on the TV and I made some absurd claim that was not religious and started soliciting donations from people for my absurd claim, I could assure you there would be some federal people coming down to check me out.
I don't know. Well, okay. I guess the Raelians have turned it into a religion, so they get that veneer of respectability.
Yeah, but if you don't have the tag, well, I mean, they sold you something at least on the Thighmaster. You actually got a product.
Right, you got a physical object.
That's advertised as another question.
Just to give you some absurd claim that's unfounded, makes no sense, and just get you to send me money, I could assure you that there's some. Somebody would come check me out.
I might want to add something, though. Yeah. For instance, Robert Tilton, who I played some of his clips just there, who's just rolling in it, he has been sued multiple times for fraud, and he's still making
it
big.
Still
so it's really, it's not even so much a matter as just getting these people in trouble. It's just a matter of educating the public.
Yeah. Right. Reminds me of the Saturday Night Live skit where they had Oral Robert, and his secretary says, God's here to see you. And the door opens up, and there's Charlton Heston wreathed in light. Oral, have you got the money? That's great.
Yeah, and I think it's very revealing to notice that the religious right is behind this big push to undermine our public education system and replace it with private education, because they don't want the public to be educated from a perspective of, like, what's for the best of the nation, what's for the good of the nation. They want to be educating the population from the perspective of what's good for their religious institutions,
yeah.
Right? They want to make sure that they have a crop of sheep who will send in their money.
The sheep.
You know, it's bad enough. It's not like our public education system is doing a really great job. We are inundated with generic mysticism and superstition on every front, and it's not just Christianity. My wife and I were in a craft store the other day, and we went into the section where it's like little jewelry things for kids, and we checked out all the what would Jesus do, and frog, couldn't believe this, frog. Fully rely on God is their new catchphrase. And kids go around with these bracelets and say, frog on them! couldn't they at least come up with something that's like marginally cool?
And yeah. Jesus wept.
Yeah. There was this section where they had the, you know, completely generic superstition stuff, the things that are kind of American Indian, kind of Eastern mysticism, kind of you don't know what the heck it is. But one of the product lines were these little round like Chinese bells. I don't know if you've ever seen those things. And usually they come in a box of two or three, and you pick them up and they jingle, bungity 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 bung. Well, they had little tiny ones and with loops on them, so you could wear them on a necklace or something. And they had little symbols drawn on them to stand for different things like luck or happiness or wealth or whatever. Well, one of them said logic, and I couldn't freaking believe it. Yeah, if you want to be more logical, what you really need to do is wear one of these Chinese bells around your neck.
Poof logic just
popped in. How could that possibly make any sense to anyone? Oh, boy. Do we got another caller? Oh, we're getting one.
All right.
Let's go to Tamara.
Yes.
Hi, Tamara. What can we do for you?
I want to talk back to the earlier topic about how you have Christian groups wanting to make this a Christian nation.
Uh-huh.
And most people don't remember their history. I mean, the Puritans who first came over here were over here. Puritanism is a Christian religion. They were from England, which the Church of England is a Christian religion. So you had two Christian religions, and one was persecuted by the other.
Exactly.
So if you make this a Christian religion, if once they cross that hurdle, they're going to be wanting
each
to
other.
Yeah, change. Okay, well, which Christian religion are we going to pick as the main one?
Right.
Because the Mormons are going to be, okay, I don't know of many Christians who want to be Mormons or Catholics or, you know, which one are we going to pick once we get to that?
Right. I've even heard some people who claim to be Christian claiming that the Catholic Church are not Christians.
Correct.
Come on, man.
Which is my favorite claim. because statistically, the UN did a census of religious persuasions around the world. If Catholics are not really Christians, then atheists, agnostics, and miscellaneous non-believers outnumber Christians worldwide.
Whoa!
According to the UN.
I read something, and I cannot remember where I read it, someone claiming that the founders of our country were all atheists, which is why we have a secular, you know.
You know, that's not correct either.
Which is not correct. They were very devout and religious men, but they were not that far removed from a time when their relatives came over for persecution for whatever, you know, beliefs that they had. So they still had a clear memory of that occurring, and they did not want that reoccurring in this country.
Exactly.
Which is why they created the government the way that they did. So there was not one religion. There wasn't a state religion.
Right. They wanted to separate that out.
And that's why Christians out there, that's why it's the way it is. So stop bitching about it.
Yes, if in fact this country is a Christian nation, let's just assume that for the moment. Why does the Christians want, you know, shouldn't they just obey the laws set up by the Christian nation? You would think they would obey them.
Yeah.
You'd think they would say, these are right laws. No.
One example that I remember about
how the Founding Fathers were thinking is during the Constitutional Convention, Benjamin Franklin and one other, I forget his name, Benjamin Franklin, by the way, was not a Christian, and he had introduced a motion to have prayers prior to the meeting, and this was allowed to die. They just didn't want to deal with that. Clearly these people, some of them were actually what they called deists,
mm-hmm.
which
right.
prior to Darwin was as close to an atheist as you can get.
they were mostly religious people, but they knew that they were not doing religion when
right.
they sat down to write our Constitution.
Right.
They were
not serving the purposes of religion. They were serving the purpose of putting together a nation that could survive.
That could
right.
function.
Thomas Jefferson wrote an amazing comment about the Constitution and the process of putting that together. He said, "Folks, we've got to get this right." I'm paraphrasing now. I don't think he said folks. "We've got to get this right because it is the nature of humanity that as soon as these laws are in place, efforts will bend toward trying to find loopholes to try to take advantage of you know, shortcuts through what we have written. We've got to make it absolutely as solid as possible because over time it's only going to degrade." And that's exactly what we are seeing now.
Yeah.
We are seeing an effort to undermine the Constitution by finding loopholes, by trying to spin it to make it sound like they're in the right.
But to their credit, though, they did a pretty good job because for a nation trying to build itself on
amazing.
The premise that all men were created equal and they were all free, during that time, those who were eligible to vote and participate were the landed gentlemen, the people who had land, property.
Yep.
And over the last 200 years, we've gone on to include other races, women, people without
yeah.
property, so we're improving, and our country's doing pretty good. We're not totally just down the flusher yet, but we still have a fight on our hands. We still have to watch this every single day. We have to constantly be vigilant of keeping our Constitution in the nature in which it was first written.
Right. Again, it is one thing to be tolerant of the existence of religions. It is quite another thing to look the other way when they do things that are just flagrantly illegal and immoral and against everyone's best interests. Well, there are people in the religious right out there who have said, in effect, we're not going to listen to what the Supreme Court says because we in our little subculture have decided what we think is right, and so we're going to act that way. Well, we have a word for people that ignore the laws of our country, okay? People who want to overthrow the government as it stands, people who want to throw out the Constitution, and that word is treason.
Yeah.
Anyway, thanks for your call, Tamara.
Thanks. Bye,
okay.
guys.
Okay, bye-bye. Anybody got anything else, or should we just go on with calls now?
We got a full slate here. Might as well
okay, let's do it.
All right.
Going to Joe.
Yeah.
Hi, Joe.
Hi, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
I'm able to catch your show sometimes on Sunday mornings.
Okay.
Which is really nice. I'm totally, right off the top, I'll tell you, I'm totally against organized religion. I think they are very dangerous and subversive.
Do you recognize their right to have organized religions if they want to, though?
If they do, it should be very quietly.
All right.
You know, and, like, you don't go to school to learn religion. You go there to learn reading, writing, and arithmetic.
Yeah.
And hopefully you'll learn something to compete, you know, in a bigger market.
Yeah.
You know, I'm totally against this whole praying in school thing. You know, that's pray for God to pay your bills. You know, that's what you could do.
And then you'll have your lights turned off.
There have been court cases of people who had, like, stopped paying their, paying for their house because they said, well, we prayed to God and we think that he said it was okay for us not to pay.
You know what? I remember that doomsday cult a few years ago in Japan. Those people sold everything off.
Yeah,
Shunrikyo. You know, I have a friend who was in the monastery, and he's left it. And you know what he said to me? The brain is a very fragile organ. It's easily manipulated and broken.
Yeah.
You know, it can be easily swayed. You know, when there's people out there that believe anything somebody tells them without doing any research, you know, they are sheep, they are fodder. And then you were talking earlier about, you know, you went to the store and you saw those bracelets. They said, what would Jesus do? What would Jesus do in this society? He'd ask, where's my cut? You know, who's getting all that money? You know, it's things that boggle my mind how people can be so ignorant and think that they're going to go to heaven. You know what? I love that. A friend of mine, his father died. You know, and it was they were doing a big funeral and everything, and I remember him. He was saying, "Well, now he's in heaven." And a friend of mine, who's somewhat leaning toward the ways I believe, she said, "You know, it's really sad how people, you know, they always make that assumption that, well, they went to heaven. You know, that's bullshit. That's BS." Okay, because a lot more of them go to hell than go to heaven.
So you believe in hell?
If that even exists. But they never say,
right.
Oh, they went to hell. Oh, they all went to heaven.
Yeah.
Now, how in the world could that happen? There ain't that much room up there. I don't believe it. I don't believe it for a day. Back to the school thing with vouchers.
Uh-huh.
I'm totally against that.
Yeah,
I will tell you right now, I am a gay man, and if they start giving vouchers to those people, they're going to indoctrinate their children, and they are going to indoctrinate their children to be totally against anything that is not like them.
Yeah, yeah.
And right. I firmly believe it will be something like that will ruin this society.
Say what you will about the state of our public education system,
but
at least...
Oh, the public education system, they've got a bunch of flakos on the school board.
But,
in the Board of Education for the state, they want to pull books. Is this 1933 Germany?
Right.
You know, what is going on with those people?
Though,
you know, as a lot of my friends refer to them as, they're heretics. Those people are off their rockers. Right. Recently, I was watching a show on investigative reports about the Mormons. Those people are out of their minds.
Yeah.
What does that do to the gene pool? They're all related to each other. I mean, talk about a bunch of dummies.
All right.
Yeah, well, the solution to the school board problem is for people who work on being rational all the time to get themselves elected to these school boards and start turning some of this nonsense around.
Yeah, it's time for people.
It's not easy. It's going to take a lot of work and a lot of diligence, but it needs to be done, and people who are qualified need to step up and do it.
Right. It's time for people who care about the common good
right.
to take a stand.
Right, right. But, you know, and some of us, it's just not feasible. We would be raked over the coals because of the amount of power they have to sway public opinion. You know, because there's still a lot of idiots out there that think, oh, I'm going to go to heaven. Right, you'll get your wings and your harp.
Yeah.
I'm going to be running the hot dog stand. I don't know about the rest of you. You know, if that's what you believe, that's great, you know.
Right.
And the other point I really wanted to make is I think that there should be legislative action started to tax churches on their property.
Agreed.
Definitely. They all own most, the Catholic Church is the biggest offender with the Protestant religions after them. They all own very, very, very prime downtown property in all major cities.
Oh, think, look at Dallas. Dallas,
yeah.
All the major property down the downtown areas, or practically all of it, rather.
Dallas, to me, is no place I would even want to live in this state. But, you know, that's beside the point. There are too many Christian heretics up there, and they're the ones that are criminals, too. What was that guy, Tilton? Wasn't that one murder his wife?
Mm-hmm. Don't know about that.
There's some guy in Fort Worth. Some preacher in Fort Worth who murdered his wife and got off with it. And
haven't heard that story.
I'll have to look that one up.
It's interesting. It's a city.
I thought it was Tilton.
No,
it's not Tilton.
Arlo, you were going to say something?
I was just saying what's interesting about Dallas, the city in general is considered one of the most religious cities in America, and yet has the highest crime rate. And the highest
right.
Yeah, I believe that.
Right. There's that idea that being a Christian makes you somehow more moral than the next guy is just totally unfounded.
Hey, caramba!
You know what? Every Christian I have met, they'll kill you in the name of God. Now, what is that all about?
That's when you put...
That's about the Old Testament.
Over, yeah.
You never hear anybody say, I'm going to kill you in the name of Buddha. You know?
Right. Well, maybe that guy from Kung Fu.
It's not always the old...
Kill you in the name of Kwai
Chang Kang. One must always remember that against the subversive Americans.
Right.
Well, thanks for your call.
Hey, guys. Good luck.
All right. Bye-bye.
We're out here.
Okay.
All right. Bye-bye.
Take it easy.
Not always the Old Testament. I do know someone personally who says that it would be their duty to kill someone if commanded by the Pope.
Yeah. Yeah, Arlo, we're having trouble hearing you in here.
Oh, sorry. Just a matter of how nuts. Far...
I don't know how well it's going out over the air. All right. Let's go on to Carl. Hi, Carl.
Hi. How are you guys doing this
Good. Morning? How are you?
Fine, thanks. I just moved to Austin, and I'm watching your show, and I was a little... I was listening to the general gist of it, and I was kind of surprised by some of the misconceptions.
Okay.
Christianity is a philosophy. The Catholic Church is a religion. Mormon Church is a religion. The Baptist Church is a religion.
Christianity is not a religion. Methodism, is that a religion?
Sure.
Okay.
That's Protestant Christianity.
Right. Fair enough.
Protestants,
no, we don't.
Whatever.
We don't.
Those are different religions that are based around Christianity.
Yeah.
Just I'm a Methodist.
Just like there's different sects of Buddhism.
Okay.
There's Shinto and whatever.
Yeah, no, we certainly are aware that there are different denominations.
Right, right. So when you say Christians, you're being pretty nonspecific.
We're doing a little lumping, but it's mostly realistic lumping.
Yeah, to an extent. Like I said, I'm not a big, I'm not a Jesus freak. I don't believe in God. I don't believe in a participatory deity at all. Mm-hmm. If I do believe in a God, it's more of the Sumerian God that is says at the end of your life, which is pretty much what the Buddhists believe in. At the end of your life, if you've lived a decent life, you get some kind of reward. Mm-hmm. Now, you might not agree with that, but that doesn't make that doesn't make me stupid or an idiot because that's what I believe in.
I wouldn't call you stupid or idiot. I would say, okay, I don't see any evidence to suggest that after you die that there's anything else.
Right.
So
right,
I tend not to latch on to a belief of something that I have no evidence for.
Well, you believe in electricity, but you don't...
No, there's evidence for electricity. I know that there's
electricity. Right, but you don't know what causes it, so... I mean, there's not a scientific basis.
What I'm
basically trying to say is that...
Oh, no.
What do you know for?
Go ahead. God, Denis will be quiet.
Okay.
You were mentioning logic before.
Yeah.
Logically, if Christians, quote, are wrong because of their belief in something that they can't prove, you cannot prove that there is not a God.
Okay.
So what you're doing is you're basing your atheism on the belief, on your faith that there isn't a God.
Burden of proof falls on the party making the positive claim. We are not making a positive claim. Any one of us would be quite willing to start believing in a God the instant somebody proved that there was one. Right?
Well, like I said, you can't prove that there isn't one.
You're not listening to me.
Yeah,
the burden of proof, this is a basic rational principle.
Yeah.
The burden of proof falls on the party making the positive claim. We are not claiming that God doesn't exist. We are just not believing in a God.
Well, I don't
it is the Christians
it.
Who are claiming that a God does exist.
I don't believe
the burden of proof falls on them.
I don't believe that. Well, they can sit there and point out to things like miraculous recoveries or whatever, which to me is kind of silly because there's people that don't have people praying for them in a situation and get better too.
Right. We can point towards more rational explanations for those.
Right. I mean, but on the other hand, you can't totally discount the belief system. Perhaps if somebody sat down and prayed for their kid, who knows? If the kid gets better miraculously, against all odds, you can't say that, well, that proves that there is no God, or you can't say that proves that there is a God.
Actually, it proves absolutely
not. What I think is that...
Wait a minute. As soon as you say it's a miraculous recovery, right, you're making an assumption that it was supernatural.
No, because, well...
Yeah.
Okay, let's parse words, okay? If somebody makes a recovery that 99.9% of the people in the same situation wouldn't make,
uh-huh.
Call it what you want. Miraculous is a word that is in our vernacular. And
we try to be
unexpected
careful.
Unexpected recovery.
We try to be careful that the assumption of, some kind of supernatural, divine underpinning to those events doesn't just sneak its way in through the language.
And
right.
Words like miraculous and belief and faith all have preconceived ideas going behind them that we have to skirt around.
If there was a God and that God wanted to be believed in, he could make it so that we would have plenty of evidence to believe in it.
I agree with you 100%. I agree with you on that. To me, that there's certain things that, demonstrable things that could prove or disprove a God or prove a God or disprove one.
There are.
I'm just saying that unless...
No, you think that there are.
What?
You think that there are such things that demonstrably prove that there is a God?
No, I told you, I don't believe in a participatory deity.
Okay.
So what I'm saying is that, you know, it's somebody's belief system. It's what gets them through a time of grief.
Yeah.
Your last caller was making fun of somebody trying to find solace in the fact that his father just wasn't gone and completely forgotten. And mm-hmm. that, to me, is not, you know, so what if somebody believes in heaven?
The problem is that we have a big movement in our country among people that believe in that stuff.
Yeah, 300,000 fringe loonies in the South, you know?
No. I think you ought to pay attention to, like, the Republican presidential race right now and the effect, and frankly, the Democrats, too. You know, Gore and Bradley have bent over backwards to try to, you know, kiss up to the religious crowd. The thing is that it doesn't just stop with, oh, I'm going to believe in this thing to make myself happy for just this moment. The assumptions that come along with the belief in a heaven and a hell and a God and the Bible and all that stuff, those assumptions all have consequences. As soon as you start taking those as your premises, you start making decisions that are based on those assumptions. And if the assumptions are not good, then the decisions that you base on those assumptions are not going
to
be good.
Well, you know, we're faced with every day with laws that are brought to us by people that not everybody agrees with.
And?
So it's the same thing. If Christians want to organize and get people elected, that's the process that we live under. If you don't want them to get elected office or whatever, organize better and get people that you know aren't fundamentalist Christians elected to office.
I basically agree with that, except that when you come to us and say, well, you can't criticize what they believe because it's just their belief, as if that somehow made it immune to criticism, then you put us at a disadvantage if we try to organize and say, look, what those people are doing is just kooky. Right? Their fundamental assumptions are just ridiculous.
Right.
You know, where does that leave us?
But, you know,
so we're going to come out
maybe,
and say,
maybe,
if we think that something somebody believes is kooky.
Before. It seems to me that you guys are basically just sitting there and going, well, Christians are jerks.
No.
You know, that might be your perspective, or there's enough to believe in one thing or another, and that might be your perspective. I'm just saying that that's probably not the way to win an argument with anybody.
We completely recognize, as that last caller didn't, okay? The last caller said we need, you know, he's against organized religion, period. I'm not against organized religion.
I'm against religion.
What I'm against...
down somebody's throat.
Huh?
You know, if people want to go to church, that's fine, but, you know, if they want to come up to tell
that's
me
fine
that I'm
with
going
me
to go
too.
To hell...
The thing that I'm against is this assumption we have in our society that something that somebody comes up with and says, well, that's my religious belief, is therefore deserves some kind of special respect, okay? That it's somehow then immune to scrutiny, that it's immune to criticism, that it's, you know, immune to challenge. That's what I have a problem with.
Well, I mean, you can criticize and challenge people on a level that's a little bit less personally offensive than some of your callers and some of the comments that you made.
That's really hard to do whenever the certain
we don't control
members
our callers.
Of the believers will take anything we say as a personal attack.
Well, you know, those are the same people that get, you know, ticked off if you don't use a turn signal when you turn in front of them. Those people, you know, you can't base... You mentioned before that some people, you know, there were some Christians that didn't want to pay for their house because they prayed and God said they didn't have to pay the mortgage company.
Yeah.
Well, I would say that, you know, you can point out to... You could probably point out to a couple loony things atheists have done. You know, if you bring up situations like that in this kind of context, it almost seems like you're making a blanket statement that here's Christians being so stupid that they stopped paying for their house because God told them to. It's like when Pat Robertson said, you know, I'm running for president because God told me to. There was a Republican in Connecticut who said, well, I talked to God this morning. He told me that Pat Robertson was full of crap. I mean, there's...
Yeah, here's the thing, okay? If to a person who believes, really, really believes... that there is a cosmic being who created the universe that cares personally about them and that will answer prayers with miraculous intervention. The idea of praying for the privilege not to have to pay for your house makes perfect sense. That's the problem. You
well,
see? It does make sense within the context of those assumptions. And so those assumptions have to be open to challenge.
Right. You can challenge them, though, but you can't say that, you know... Well,
If I'm making a blanket statement, right? If you, and I didn't, of course, make a blanket statement that all Christians are going out trying not to pay for their house.
Right.
My point is, this right. is where belief in these unprovable supernatural assumptions leads. It does lead there. If there are people who are not asking to be free from having to pay for their house on the basis of they prayed to God, those are people who I don't think understand the implications of their own belief system.
Yeah, but see, they're free to do that. You know, they're people in this country.
Okay.
And the mortgage company is completely right by taking their house back.
All right.
Well, yeah, I'm not arguing. Hey, you guys, thanks for your time.
Yeah, we're going to have to move on. Thanks very much for your call. You just moved to town, you said?
I'm sorry, yeah.
Okay, well watch our show more. We'll be
hey, man,
call
I'm
back
watching
anytime.
You every Sunday morning. Like I said, right. I'm not arguing with you. I'm just presenting a couple different perspectives.
Okay.
Yeah, well, thanks for your input.
Yeah, thanks for your call.
Adios.
Bye-bye. Go to Todd.
Todd.
Todd,
how you guys doing?
Hi, how are you?
I'd like to make a comment.
Okay.
Thank God for y'all full of shit.
Oh, I'm...
Who the hell are you?
You feel better, Todd? I hope so.
Okay, thanks for your call.
It's nice to provide free therapy.
Yeah.
And Rock.
Hi, guys. You had to hang on a long time for that comment.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, a couple things. First, there was a nice piece in the paper today about Steve Weinberg.
Really? Yeah, was there?
Yeah, insight section. And they did bring up his religious beliefs and so forth. Mm-hmm. And it was very refreshing to see that in the paper.
Steven
Is that
Weinberg.
In Statesman?
Say what?
Statesman?
Yeah, today.
Okay, I'll have to look
Steven
that up.
Steven Weinberg did a lecture, one of our lecture series one time. He was an excellent speaker, and he made a lot of sense.
Oh, yeah, big hero of mine.
Yes.
And I think he's, you know, here's a guy who's won a Nobel Prize, probably understands the nature of cosmology and the universe, you know, top 10 in the world.
Yeah.
And he's so strong and adamant about the problems of organized religion.
Right. And he takes a clearly opposite stance of... what's his name, Elliot Gould or Jay Gould?
Right.
Stephen Jay Gould.
Stephen Jay Gould.
Elliot Gould
Gould's
is
an
actor.
One of them Gould
boys. I don't know
boys.
What stance Elliot Gould takes.
Anyway, the reason I called is you guys made a comment about privatizing education and the organized religion being behind that and so forth. I want to be very clear. I mean, I am against vouchers 100%. Mm-hmm. But privatizing education... is not that bad an idea. I was brought in, educated by a Catholic school, and my parents didn't get any remuneration for the government for doing that. But boy, I got a much better education than the people in my city who didn't go to private schools.
Yeah. But I think the problem here is the assumption that just because right now there are some private schools that do a better job than most public schools, that therefore there's something about the private education system that makes it better. And I think if you look at, say, those countries where their students get higher test scores than we do in the United States on standardized tests.
That's almost all of them, okay.
Those countries have public education. So, there is clearly something going wrong with our public education right now, but I think the answer is to fix it.
Yeah, and
I don't think the answer is to break up that responsibility so that each individual special interest group can miseducate their children to their tastes.
And I
think that's a real bad idea.
I think accountability and having a marketplace of ideas and having real competition in the school system is a positive step, and I would like to see that.
Yeah.
And I know the religious groups would, quote-unquote, take advantage of it, but so we would be able to take advantage of it with our own kids. I think it would be very positive.
And my concern is not whether my kids, of which I don't have any, and I'm not going to. My concern is not the education quality of my own personal kids. My concern, and I think the federal government's concern, is and ought to be, are we a nation full of reasonably well-educated people, or are we a nation full of kooks and wackos? That's
my
concern.
That's not going to be the motivation behind a government school. A government school is going to be, are we going to have a people who are being compliant to the government?
I take issue with that if
I had to choose between are we going to have people who are compliant to whichever organization happens to be running the school that they took, right, the private school that they took, or are we going to have a single school system that everybody can look at and complain about
and point fingers at, even if it's government run, I'd rather have the government one. Yeah. But we could go around forever on this issue.
Well,
I understand your arguments, and I think
if you give that power to the government,
yeah,
then you are allowing people who could get control of the government through political means,
yeah,
to do what they will.
And that is exactly what we've had.
Let me point out exactly something about when you say the government, because that sounds a little close to conspiracy theory. When you talk about American government, we are a government of the people. And if there's this problem with government, it's really because lots of people don't participate. You have voter apathy is rampant. People just don't concern themselves with the issues that are affecting them directly. I know way too many people who are willing to just turn a blind eye to anything that is political at all. And if you want to fix public schools, the solution is to get involved. And if you think that there's a problem,
go and speak up. Let me respond to your previous point. I mean, we've had 200 years, well over 200 years now, for any one interest group to get control of our government and try to keep it. And it's never worked that way. Some groups come to power, they run it for a while, they screw up, they get kicked out. And it changes over time. But if you have a Catholic school, right, or a Mormon school, or a Baptist school, they've got control of that institution forever.
But they don't have control over the
individual. There is never going to be any opportunity for anybody to go in there and say, man, what you are telling your students is just freaking kooky.
They don't have control over the individuals.
Right. And it's individuals who ultimately together vote and make the decisions for
right,
our federal government.
Right, but I am paying my taxes to pay for an institution that I don't want to support. So your approach is to force people to support a government school when they're not interested in that. I think that has implications about what you're willing to do with other people's lives and other people's money that are not healthy.
Yeah, I recognize that in a perfect world, everybody would pay only for exactly the services that they used. Okay, but it's not a perfect world, and I don't think there's anything wrong.
Well, you brought up utopia here. I didn't.
I'm not interested in utopia. But this whole attitude, and I would say you, because this is a lot of people are saying this sort of thing these days. The whole attitude that, well, if I don't like that thing that the government is doing, then I shouldn't have to pay for it, right? The idea there is that everything ought to be broken down so that everybody is only paying for precisely the services that they want and use, right? And I mean, sure, I can see the utopian value of that, but it's not that kind of a world, and I don't think there's anything wrong with recognizing that there are practical considerations that, you know, we don't want to have our road system paid for by having toll booths at every single corner so that everybody is paying only for precisely the amount of roads that they use, right? I mean, there is a limit to that. At some point, I don't think there's anything wrong with the government saying, we're going to have this thing, and it's going to work this way, and if you don't like it, you can vote and interact with the system that way, but we're going to charge everybody for it because it's for the good of the country. Anyway, we could go around on that forever, so we probably ought to end it now.
Well, I just want to be careful. When you talk about vouchers and you talk about private, don't lump them together. They're quite different from each other.
Right.
Vouchers are reimbursing people, and they're actually taking their money back from the government. Private is people are doing with it what they will with their own resources.
And I certainly have nothing wrong with that.
And I think I just want to be careful that you don't lump those together.
Fair enough.
Also, there are people who are running for State Board of Education
who are
very interested in seeing that things like homeschooling and other kinds of options are properly supported in this state.
No.
And certainly we want to consider supporting those kind of people. And then, yes, they're the kind of people who don't have the standard byline of that you see of most of the assembly people around the state. If you go to the state right now, and you look at all these people in the House and the Senate and the state, I think it's 100% are either Methodists or Presbyterians or some sort of nominational Christian. And that's, people are going to have to wake up and do something about that.
Agreed. I would love to see an atheist in office one of these days. Thanks for your call.
Take care.
Bye-bye. Going to Buster.
Hey.
Hi.
Well, if you don't think there's a hell yet, just haven't watched an argument between a Christian and atheist.
I have participated in arguments between a Christian and an atheist.
It's excruciatingly painful, unbearably heated, and it goes on forever and ever. Yeah. But what I want to know is if y'all have any history on or know what the story is behind. If you say, okay, this was not built as a Christian nation, first thing the Christian's going to do is reach in the collection plate, hand you a quarter, and say, read that. Who, do you know who was behind putting in God We Trust? Why in separation of church and state? And now here, let's put this on the coin.
Do you know the exact details?
I know. The determined God We Trust was put on some of the coins throughout history, but it did not appear on the dollars until 1954, I believe it was. This is McCarthyism. This was when the big Red Scare was going on, and we needed to align ourselves with
rally.
Something. And they rallied behind the In God We Trust. Matter of fact, in the Pledge of Allegiance, I don't know if you ever took that when you were in school, but prior to, I think, 54 at the same time, or a little later, maybe 56, One Nation Under God, the word under God, did not appear in the original Pledge of Allegiance.
Right.
All of this stuff about In God We Trust and all that stuff on the money, the original slogan for this country was E Pluribus Unum, of many one. And that was the original Founding Fathers' idea of what this nation should stand for. And you can blame McCarthyism, really, for the In God We Trust on the money.
Okay. On the paper money.
On the paper money,
in the
yes.
50s. But like Vic said, that phrase did get onto some coinage throughout, or farther back, and I don't know the exact details on that.
It's been off and on throughout.
It's also important to remember that God, that the term God meant something different to a lot of our founding fathers than it means to fundamentalists.
Right.
Since many of them were deists and only thought of God in the sense that, you know, it's like some ineffable something that pervades everything, and we don't really know what it is, you know, but it seems kind of cool, you know. That's about it.
And that wouldn't fit on the coin. Yeah.
Right.
All right, thanks.
The coin had to be about this big.
Thanks for your call. And Jacob.
Yeah.
Hi, Jacob.
How's it going?
Good. How are you?
Pretty good. I just had a comment slash question sort of thing about what you guys were saying about challenging Christians to prove that God exists and things like that.
They can't, and most will admit that they can't. But the point is that if there is going to be a proof, it has to come from them. It is unfair of them to expect non-believers to prove he doesn't exist.
Right. Yeah, and I totally agree with that. And the thing is, I don't believe that we can prove anything at all, like philosophically.
No, what do you mean by proof? Do you mean with absolute certainty?
Yeah.
I agree.
Okay.
Right.
So, yeah, I mean, so basically I just ask myself, where is the evidence point? And so, I mean, I don't really throw the ball in anybody's court to say, you know, you must prove without, you know, a shadow of a doubt to prove it to me, you know?
Right. Proof in science, which is where, you know, most of us get our definition.
Yeah.
A proof in science is just, you know, the most comprehensive explanation of all of the available evidence.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if you've got an explanation for something that accounts for everything that we know better than any other explanation anybody else has come up with, that is considered, you know, proof enough in science for that to be given provisional acceptance.
Right.
But it's willing to change at any moment should new data come to light that doesn't fit.
Right. Exactly. I mean, I totally agree with you. And
it's always, I mean, it really is all about just, you know, trying to make the most sensible decision you can based on what you know.
Right.
That is no guarantee that you won't make mistakes.
Right.
It is a guarantee that you haven't cut yourself so much slack that you can conclude any wild nonsense at all that has no basis in anything.
Totally. Right. I mean, I think the point that, I mean, I usually come after thinking about this kind of stuff is that everybody, you know, Christian, atheist, Muslim, you know, Buddhist alike, eventually makes a sort of leap of faith based on all the evidence that they have. I mean, wouldn't you agree with that?
Well, the faith word has numerous interpretations.
Oh, okay.
If all you mean is there is less than 100% certainty, and all of us have to close that gap. That's the warning that the show's about to end. Let me try to wrap this up quick.
Okay, thanks.
If all you mean is closing that gap, well, that gap can be small or it can be big, and the smaller the better, because that kind of faith shouldn't be something that everybody thinks is wonderful and cool. It should be looked at as a distasteful chore. It's too bad that we can't have absolute certainty. We should just try to do the best we can. Thanks for watching, everybody. Oh, we're doing this our photo effect again. Watch us next week. Thanks to all of our callers.
And
thanks, Denis, for being on the show. Vic, excellent job as usual.
Thank you. That's our love.
We will be going to the bagel shop after this at near the corner of 5th and Lavaca, the Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop, for our regular meeting. We have the board of directors meeting today, and bye, Austin. Hey, Christian, we don't hate you. We just think you're wrong.